name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Psalms 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us and not us, not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. I read to you Psalms 100, 1 through 5. The word is already blessed.
Father God in heaven, we come to you, Lord, on today, Lord, to thank you, Lord, for
thank
allowing
you.
Your son to come
thank
down.
Thank you, Lord.
To be risen on today, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We thank you for a risen Savior, Lord.
Hallelujah.
He loves us and died for us instead.
Hallelujah.
Lord, on today, Lord, we just invite you into your house.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
We ask that your presence be with us, Lord, right now, Lord, so that we can worship you, Lord,
yeah,
for who you are, Lord. And right now, Lord, we ask you that you bless the ones that are
bless,
here, Lord,
Lord,
and bless every church that's opening your son,
yes,
Jesus' name, Lord,
yes,
this risen Sunday, Lord. We just ask you, Lord, to be with those that are on their way, Lord.
Yes.
And right now, Lord, we ask you that you continue to encourage and strengthen our pastor,
in the name,
Lord,
of Jesus,
as you continue to lead your people, Lord.
In the name
and right
of
now,
Jesus.
Lord, we ask this in your son, Jesus,
yes,
the Christ. Amen. Matthew 28. Give everybody a chance to get there. End of the Sabbath, as it began, and dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre.
And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it.
His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow.
And for fear of him, the people did shake and became as dead men.
And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified.
He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay.
And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee, that shall he see him. Lo, have I told you.
And they departed quickly from the serpent with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word.
And it says, and as they went telling his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him.
Then said Jesus unto them,
be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me.
Now, when they were gone, behold, some of the watch came into. I'm sorry, let me start over. Now, when they were gone, behold, some of the watch came into the city, and showed him unto the chief priests all the things that were done.
And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large monies unto the soldiers,
saying, say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept.
And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you.
So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day.
Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee and into the mountains where Jesus had appointed them.
And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubt.
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
early Sunday morning.
Yeah.
The preachers would say early. It tells us exactly that. So we want to just share in song together, and then we will continue in this worship service, this time of giving God praise. I love getting up on Resurrection Sunday.
Amen, amen.
I'm not always great about getting up in the morning, but when it's Sunday, Easter, there's something about
waking
up and seeing heaven come up.
Yeah.
That just excites me. Amen. So we praise the Lord for that. Amen.
Amen.
And I praise the Lord for your presence here on today. Amen.
Thank you.
It is a day celebrated by Christians throughout the world.
Yes, yes.
But the reason that they separate this day from all others is because it offers us an opportunity to refocus our lives on why we have access to salvation.
Yeah. Amen.
Some years ago, a popular English novelist wrote a book called When It Was Dark. And the story centers around the efforts of a wealthy unbeliever to discredit Christianity. He endeavors to do this by attempting to discredit the resurrection.
All right.
In that respect, his logic, if you think about it, is sound. If he can dispute the resurrection or discredit it, then Christianity doesn't exist anymore.
All right. Yeah.
Because Christ didn't rise. Mm-hmm. On the tomb of him, there was this, he hired a man who was an archaeologist to fake a discovery of the body of Jesus in the neighborhood of Jerusalem. Yes. This man saw or put on the tomb an inscription testifying that the owner of this sepulcher stole the body of Jesus and hid it there. Mm-hmm. Then the novel goes on to describe the ultimate effect of such a discovery. If accepted as truth upon the Christian world, upon the Christian church, and upon civilization in general. Mm-hmm. So the powerful passage that he shows, gradually the Christian church crumbles and collapses. How men and women go back to lust, cruelty, and animalism.
Yeah.
And how the flame of hope dies out in every human heart.
All right, then.
Had the body of Christ ever been found, or a grave in which it could be proved that his body had been placed, other than that of Joseph of Arimathea, the church would indeed disappear, and the sun of human hope would set in our hearts and in darkness of an everlasting and ever-ending life.
Yeah.
But thanks be to God.
Yes. Yeah.
And our Christ is risen from the dead.
All right.
All right.
Yeah.
And on that empty tomb is the epithet written by the angels, the epithet that ends all epithets that go on. It said in Luke 16:6,
all right,
he is risen.
Yeah.
He is not here.
Yeah.
Behold the place where they laid him.
Yes.
And so today I want to talk about his resurrection, our time also to rise.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And so he is not there is the first point that I want to make. In verse 6 in Matthew 28, he says, he is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay.
Yes.
And what that teaches us is, and the reason that we are here early on a Sunday morning.
Amen, amen. Right,
to celebrate, to commemorate, to look to a risen Savior.
Yeah.
We don't have a Savior who is dead and stayed dead. We have a Savior who died for our sins and who rose from the grave. That is something that no other religion can proclaim nor has claimed. So therefore, what we stand for as believers in Jesus Christ is we stand for a risen Savior. He is not here, for he is risen. And there are three truths that I want you to hear from this passage. The tomb in which Jesus was buried was discovered empty by a group of women on a Sunday morning following his crucifixion. After Jesus had died, after Jesus had been crucified, after he had said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Amen.
After he had said, Mother, here is your son, and son, here is your mother. After he had taken care of all that he had to take care of, Jesus died. It wasn't that he was half asleep or that he was in unconscious. Jesus died on the cross.
Yes.
But he was buried in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb. And he was, so we say he was buried in a borrowed tomb. Because it wasn't his.
Come on, amen, amen.
So he didn't have to stay in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb.
Right.
Because he rose from the dead.
Amen. All right.
That was the first point. That women located where Jesus had been buried, but he was no longer there. Important about that is this, that the Romans had guards around where Jesus was.
Yes, yes, yes.
And the cost of losing that body would have meant that they would be killed.
Yeah.
There was no way that they were to survive under the circumstances of losing a body of one who they believed was causing insurrection. And by the fact that he said, "I will rise again," they put a big rock in front of the tomb so that Jesus could not escape. However, early Sunday morning, when the rock was rolled away, and the angel is sitting on top of the rock saying, "What are you looking for, Jesus? He's not here." He rose just like he told you he would. And so these ladies who were going to anoint his body because they had to hurry up and bury him were the first ones there. There's something to be said about women making it to the tomb first. The fellas was back home chilling, I think, just cooling, going, "Oh, Jesus is gone." But the women had a job to do, and they were going to anoint his body.
All right.
But they are the first to discover that he is no longer in the tomb.
All right.
Second point, the second truth I want you to see is that Jesus' disciples had real experiences with Jesus, whom they believed was the risen Christ.
All right.
That's important to understand.
Yes, it is.
Because a lot of Muslims, a lot of people who don't believe in Jesus Christ, a lot of people who mock our faith, talk about the fact that we did not, or Jesus didn't die and then rose again.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They argue the fact that that could not have happened because it is not natural. But God operates in the supernatural. So if you don't understand the supernatural of God, you cannot understand God's ability to be able to raise or make somebody rise from the dead.
Amen.
But here they have witnessed Jesus himself had raised Lazarus from the dead. But God did something so miraculous that 3 days in the grave, he raises Jesus from the dead.
Amen.
So they had, he told them to go to Jerusalem and he would meet them there.
Yeah.
And the Bible records, and each of the gospel writers tell us that they saw him.
Yes.
And that the disciples saw him. So it wasn't that this situation where some people said, "Well, we think we saw him," or we think that we saw him, we might have seen him around, we're not sure. His disciples saw him. So let me explain it this way. Would you be willing to go and possibly die for telling the truth that you knew was a lie? No, most of us would not. So they had to have seen Jesus, because After Jesus ascended back to heaven, the disciples were charged with going to tell the world that Jesus rose. Now, if he didn't rise from the grave, then it would be crazy of them to be going around telling a lie and sacrificing their lives for a lie. But they didn't. They stood by the word that he had risen. They had broken bread with him, ate fish with him. They had had a supper with him. And they had heard his teaching before he ascended back to heaven. So they had real experiences with him. And as a result, this is the third point, as a result of the preaching of these disciples, which had the resurrection at its center, the Christian church was established and grew. We would not be as a church. We would not be here as a church had they not taken what Jesus said and went and established the church. He told Peter, "Upon this rock I will build my church." The rock that he was building it on was his resurrection from the grave. It wasn't on Peter. It was on Jesus and what he stood for. So those are the three things. He is not there. But the second thing that this passage teaches me is that the lie won't hold. Y'all have to deal with that. Not only is he not there, but Matthew 28:11-15, listen what they said. "Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch," that's the guards, "came unto the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done." So let me just break that down real quick. What happened is the guards now have to go tell the chief priests of the Jews that Jesus' body is no longer in the tomb. They've been guarding the tomb. But now something has happened, and they go to tell the chief priest everything that happened. Hey, we was there, and all of a sudden, we couldn't get away. We don't know what happened, but all of a sudden the body is no longer in the tomb.
Come on, we
didn't move the rock. If we moved the rock, we would be dead. Because we know that they would kill us. So we had to guard the body with our lives. But all of a sudden the body is no longer in the tomb.
Amen.
So they come and they tell the truth. But look at what happens, verse 12. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, that means they had a conversation. They gave them, they done told them what happened. They gave them a large amount of money to the soldiers who were guarding the tomb. And they said to them, say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away. Now the first part of this is, if you understand being a guard and being a soldier, if you lose the thing that you're supposed to be guarding, the penalty for that is death. So they're telling them to lie and say that the disciples came and stole Jesus' body and took it away. Which means that then the disciples would have had to overpower the guard
in order to get
the body out of the tomb. So the chief priests, who was the haters, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they were the haters of Jesus Christ. Didn't believe in him, didn't love him, didn't care about him. They're trying to bribe somebody to lie. But like I said, the lie won't hold.
And
I've learned over the years that people can lie on you, but it don't necessarily translate to holding the truth.
All right.
They cannot hold up to the truth.
Right.
And so they came, they told him that this is what they said. And they said in verse 14, and if this come to the governor's ears, in other words, we're going to have you back. If people start talking about Jesus is no longer there, we got your back. We're going to tell them that, no, the disciples came and stole his body. So we got you. I don't know why they would trust some folk that's telling them to lie anyway. Right? And the Pharisees and Sadducees did not have a good record of holding up their word anyway. But they believed them and they took the money. And so then it says in 15, so they took the money and did as they were taught. They had been told. They coached. They were coached. Just tell them that the disciples came and stole the body and while you all slept. And we're going to back you up with the governor in case the governor say something. We got you. And it says, this is commonly reported among the Jews until this day, that Jesus' body was stolen. And even people today, some people say his body was stolen today. But we believe otherwise.
Amen.
We know that God raised him. There was a story by a popular novelist, an English novelist, who wrote a book called When It Was Dark. The story centers about the efforts of a wealthy unbeliever, again, to discredit the resurrection. He seeks to do this by doing some things that put Jesus, you know, just basically that would lie. And I told you this earlier, but he basically is trying to create a lie that he believes will hold up.
Amen.
And how many times in your own life have you been lied on? How many times has somebody tried to tell you that what you're doing or who you are or what you've done, and you know it's not the truth, but you got to fight against a lie? Most of you, I gather, haven't had to deal with that. But I can tell you that if you've ever had to deal with the fact that somebody's lying on you, then you understand the damage that it can do. But here's what I found out. For centuries, haters have sought to say that the resurrection is not true. They don't believe Jesus rose from the dead, even though the Bible confirms that his disciples saw him. That's one group. And that they touched his resurrected body. Remember what he said to Thomas. He said, Thomas, I know you don't believe. You can come and put your finger in my nail-scarred hand. Right where they nailed my hand. He said, you can touch that area of my body. You can see that they pierced my hands. They pierced my feet. Then he spoke to over 500 disciples. The Bible says that he spoke to them before he ascended back to heaven.
Yes.
But haters and non-believers don't want to hear that it's true that he rose again.
All right.
They don't believe that he rose again, because if they believe he rose again, then they got to answer some other questions about why they don't believe in the resurrection.
Come on, Matt.
They sought to perpetuate untrue stories about the Lord and try to argue against Jesus rising from the grave. Mm. But the Bible is clear.
Yeah.
He rose from the dead.
Yeah.
So not only is he not there, not only will a lie not hold, but Jesus' resurrection charged us to tell others.
Uh-huh.
Matthew 18, 28-18, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power. It's given unto me in heaven and in earth.
Yeah.
Go ye therefore and teach all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Amen.
Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And I came across an alarming sight. As he passed by a house, he noticed that the entire back half of the house was engulfed in flames.
Yes.
He saw it, and looking in the front glass doors, he saw a young family that was eating and enjoying and drinking and having a good time, a fun family-filled evening, completely unaware that what was happening in the back of their house. What should he do? They looked so happy. Should he interrupt their fun and warn them that their house is burning down? Or should he walk on by because they may not appreciate having that family night interrupted? But here's what I learned. Jesus' last days on earth after the resurrection was command concern for the world.
Yeah.
He called his disciples, you and I, to reach others for him.
Yeah.
And just like he called the disciples to reach them,
yeah,
we have a responsibility as we see people walking through life, looking like they're enjoying their life and don't have a care in the world, getting high, getting drunk, having sex, doing whatever.
Yeah.
We need to stand up and be the one to tell them that where they're going and the way that they're going is not going to get them to heaven. Do you want the house to burn down and them in it? Or because they look like they're having a good time, or do you want their soul to be saved?
Yes.
That was a decision that only you and I can make when we see the situation.
Yeah.
And if you don't understand the urgency that Jesus said, go be therefore
and
teach and to make disciples. I want you to baptize them. If you don't understand that the world is on fire and there is a short period of time before those folk are going to hell, and you and I have water to try to put the fire out for them, but we won't do it. We're holding our voices. We're walking as they're walking and walking on our way to hell.
Yes.
And God is saying, that is not what I called you to do.
Yes.
My son died so that they might live, and you know who they are.
Yes.
You need to go out and go tell somebody Jesus still saved them. I saved the world from the dead. Rose from the dead.
Yes.
I have an obligation. I have a commitment to that he saved my life from a burning hell.
Yes.
I gotta tell somebody else that that my Savior still lives. Redeemer lives. He is not dead. He gave up his life, but then he took it back.
Yes.
After he rose from the dead.
Amen.
Now,
amen.
He set the right hand of the Father and see on my behalf. Jesus rose from the dead. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And I'm excited today. Because I got a Savior that rose. And he gave all power to me and to
Say it, Pastor.
Easter.
Yes.
In 40 words.
Mm-hmm.
By Debbie McDaniel. Love gave.
Yes.
Help came.
Yeah.
Compassion reached.
Said that.
Mercy saved.
Yes.
Beauty filled.
Yes.
Hope instilled.
Yes.
Burdens lifted.
Yes.
Grace revealed.
Yes.
Death ended.
Yes.
Breach mended.
Yes.
Joy danced.
Yes.
Peace extended.
Yes.
Curtain torn.
Yes.
Power soared.
Yes.
Freedom breathed.
Yes.
Life reborn.
Yes.
He forgave.
Yes.
Truth overcame.
Yes.
Glory rose.
Glory.
and light today reigns.
Yeah.
God is still in the blessing business.
Yes.
He not only rose or raised his son from the dead, but he has promised today that we can be committed to that as well.
Yes.
Too many of our people, too many of our folk are walking around like we got all day.
Right.
All the rest of our lives before we walk right
and
walk in righteousness.
Yes.
And God is saying, now is the acceptance. Yeah.
Now is the time.
Now is the time that you need to change the way that you walk in if you are not walking right. Make this Easter the day that you decide, I'm going to live for the Lord, because the Lord lived and died and lived again for me.
Amen.
Amen. I've been playing, or I've been doing, and I have not kept the Lord on my mind. And because I haven't done that, God has still been graceful to me, has extended grace to me, has given me an opportunity to be able to get it together. And I thank him for that. But it's more than just thanking him for that. You need to begin to commit your life to walking with him in righteousness. It means absolutely nothing for us to say, I'm a Christian, but don't look like a Christian.
Come on,
don't
come on.
Don't walk like a Christian.
Come on now.
Don't talk like a Christian.
All right.
Don't act like a Christian. God is looking at you and I and waiting for us to get our lives together to commit to him. He'll do the rest.
Yeah.
We just have to do our best.
Yes.
And not just slack off.
That's right.
Amen.
That's
right.
This is the word of the Lord. We extend the invitation.
Amen, amen. Say it, Pastor.
We extend the invitation to Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And at this time, we extend that invitation knowing that we also have an opportunity to recommit our own lives to the cause of Christ.
Amen, amen.
He loved us enough to go to the cross and die.
Amen,
he loved
amen.
Us enough to be able to give his life.
Yeah.
He loved us enough to die for us.
Yes.
And then he loved us even more by getting up out of the grave.
Amen.
You and I have access to the Father because Jesus rose again.
Yeah.
So we extend the invitation.
Thank you, Lord.
You may come by letter by Christmas.